With Jennifer Botterill, Kevin Bieksa, Kelly Rudy, and to the point is the Stanley Cup playoffs are right around the corner. We've got 6 weeks roughly left, and Kelly, Stanley Cup is a marathon of skill, of attrition, but more than anything, of focus, and we're starting to see
yes.
it.
Yes, and what a difference for Samsonov from, say, 2.5 months ago, right? If you would have thought that you'd see him here in mid-March play this well after the start he had, but watch his focus. He never takes his eye off the puck, and I mean never. While the play's going on, he will track that thing until the whistle blows. That we are always taught that as a goaltender. Even if your team has perfect control like Toronto did on that one, you're always thinking that there could be a turnover and you have to be ready. That is just ultra focused. That is fantastic. I love it. And you know, I'm sure he's hoping the playoffs start anytime now because he is ready. He is dialed in.
The message is never trust the defenseman.
It is.
The puck behind the net.
I am telling you, it is.
There's bad bounces yes. and crazy things that happen. Never trust a D young goal.
And I don't care how good the defenseman that has the puck on a stick, you always think he's going to turn it over.
There's a briskness to how quickly he's tracking right? that puck with his head movements. It's amazing.
It's awesome.
How about Caden Primo?
Okay, this is a good story because he had only one start since the trade deadline. We know they got rid of Allen. So you want to make a statement in that one game, right? So he has a 41 save shutout in that one. He's only given up one in this first period. What a great opportunity for him. I believe this is only his 37th NHL game. So he's 24 years old. This is a great opportunity for he and Montembeault to really show the organization that thank you for the opportunity. And we really respect this opportunity that we have. And so I like this. They're two good young goaltenders. They made the right move by getting rid of Allen at the time. Make sure these guys are kind of ready for the opportunity.
And Jennifer, you really see the focus in off-day activities. So Ben Sherratt goes at Raymond in the Detroit practice, and we all get a big kick out of it. What do you think about it?
Well, interesting, because they weren't the only team that had a skirmish this week. In Vancouver, they had a little one, too. It's just a sign, I think, of the time of the season, of the intensity, the demands in practice, right? And I think in those battle drills, at this time of the year, you're pushing each other. And I feel like this one fades out pretty quickly. But I just feel like it's an indication, right? This team was on a bit of a slide. They know they need to be far better if they're going to remain in a playoff spot. So this is just a sign. I think his teammates, too, demanding more. Like, if you don't see what you want from your teammates, you've got to demand more in these moments in between games.
I've seen this a few times in my career, and it's usually when the team's struggling, and it's usually, I don't know why, but between a defenseman, a tough, hard-nosed defenseman, and a forward. Think Bortuzzo and Samford years ago that everybody's claims sparked the St. Louis series. And it comes down to competing and wanting maybe some of your skill guys to play a little bit harder when you're not winning. Like, that seems to always be the common thread. But it worked for Detroit because they won today. Mm-hmm. Another guy they have who's uber competitive is David Perron. And I'm watching the game today, and I know this personality. You watch him here. He gets cross-checked in the back here, and there's no call, and it ends up setting up a grade A for Buffalo. This was a huge game standing-wise. Implications in the wild card. Perron yells at the referee. Now he's yelling at the linesman because he missed that too many men call. He takes his helmet off. He's fired up. He's engaged into the game. And then you'll see him towards the end of the game. Buffalo pulls the goaltender. Darlene is on the ice for two and a half minutes. He's going to ice this puck. Then he tries to pull a fast one, go to the bench, pretend he was changing, sit down. The linesman had to come over the ref and say, get it back on the ice. I know you're on here. And then watch Perron's waiting. He knows he's doing a stall tactic. Going to put a little shoulder into him. So he yelled at the ref. He yelled at the linesman. He yelled at Darlene. I used to carpool with him, and he would yell at me if I didn't pick the right lane. Like, get in that lane. Get in that lane. Like, he's just an intense guy. He's won with St. Louis. He lost in the finals to Vegas. And he's trying to help a young team get into the playoffs.
And you can tell the officials respect him because they didn't tell him to shut up or anything, right? Because normally they'll, you stop it right now or whatever, I'll give you two, or they just let him go on because they knew he is right.
But the description intensity, I think that's what even came out of the Canucks, sort of moment earlier this week. That's what they said, even the coaching staff. They said, okay, let's see this as intensity within our group.
So another talk of the town was John Hines decides to pull his goalie, and some say he should have done it in regulation, but regardless, he did do it in a key moment for the Wild.
But I also feel like you've got more space in overtime. And so, yes, people are saying, is this too risky? Well, yes, there's a risk to it, but I also feel like this call, this is belief in your team. Yes, it's very assertive, but when you have all of this space in a 4-on-3, I like the call. I mean, it paid off for them. Boldy gets the overtime winner. I mean, you think about the standings, these decisions that are being made, right? Nashville's ahead of them in the standings. They need the points. It's bold, but I feel like that's trust in your team. I like it.
I like it too. Fedorov did it in the KHL this year, and he won as well. did it in overtime. I do agree with Jeff Merrick, and he made the comment this week, though. It might be a better decision to do it still in regulation.
You just don't have the space.
I like the unpredictability about it, too. Like, I like the space. I think like 3-on-3 and you create a 4-on-3. A 5-on-4, there's not as much room. And it's a bit of a sneak attack. So usually when you have a 4-on-3 kill, you put out your three penalty killers that know what they're doing. In that case, those are three guys that don't necessarily know what they're doing.
Islanders lost their game today, but they got a point out of the game because the guy who pulls his goalies with 10 to go, Patrick Roy, introduced the concept, and he pulled his goalie to go 6-on-4. Bo Horvat, a huge goal for New York. So it is that time of the year when teams are pulling out the tactics and pulling out some of the spirit of what's required, including those Wild with that come from behinds.
Jeep 4x Electric Studio, powered by Jeep Plug-in Hybrid Electric Grand Cherokee 4xe and Wrangler 4xe. Jeep, making freedom electric.